Can somebody give me a good answer as to why the statues should come down? I'd love to know why the statues should come down. Do you not realize that? Do you not realize that people lost their lives? Do you currently have anybody in your family that is alive today that was a slave? Have you personally experienced slavery? 1926. Okay, so he experienced slavery. See, that's what I'm talking about. Y'all have no good reason why you're out here. Y'all have no good reason why you're out here. I'm giving you free publicity for riding with the outlaw. Right now is your time to speak and say why you're here.
Let me just tell you one thing, and I'm talking to you calmly because I actually have entertained you coming in here and you haven't bothered anybody, even though I have received numerous complaints from customers that are trying to come in here and have a good time and enjoy themselves.
I haven't bothered the first person. I've only wanted to be left alone when I come in here. Look at the cameras.
A business and you call either myself or Ashley a derogatory term, that is the response you're going to receive. This is your formal notice. Excuse me. This is your formal notice. Excuse me.
You know, that doesn't really prove anything, but other than us as a community, we do need to get together and try to figure out our problem resolution here, because Matt Reardon is a danger to our society. And he's going to be a problem, mark my words.
I'm a Marine Corps veteran. I'm a patriot. I'm a 3%er. I took an oath at the end of 2007 to uphold and defend our Constitution from all enemies, both foreign and domestic. Why would you even answer that? Look. Hey, y'all will not respond to anything, any email, any public records request, anything. I want to know why. I am holding our county officials accountable for this. You know I was framed. We've already had that discussion, Joey. I swore an oath to our country and ultimately wrote a blank check to our government for an amount up to and including my life. I wasn't deployed. I was never sent to a deployable squadron. I was in the air wing, and I was part of a non-deployable squadron that actually trained new pilots to fly the AV-8B Harrier and then get assigned to a gun squadron and sent overseas to drop bombs on Iraq. I personally find my MOS and my job very crucial to the readiness of the Marine Corps and its officers to go and drop bombs on the bad guys.
Matthew Reardon. Mr. Reardon, I want to give you a warning one time only. The next time you call up here, the next time you give anybody in my staff a hard time, I'm going to have you arrested for contempt of court. But not to come up here, when you call up here, you have to meet the record.
Your Honor, how did I do
that? Be quiet, sir. I understand you want to discuss something with me. Let's hear it. What do you want to discuss with me?
I was simply trying to inquire on the outcome of my act. She falsely accused me of rape. You've created a monster.
Please, Your Honor. Take him all back. Take him all back to the back. Go back, sir. I'm going to hold you against the court. Take him all back.
Your Honor, I was just take trying to address back. This.
All right, sir. Let's go. Come on. You want to go on your own?
Go back. Your Honor, please. My wife is outside.
I don't care.
My wife is outside. My wife is outside.
So which one?
I was hoping to get a comment from you.
You're not going to get anything from me. I have nothing to say to you.
I'd like to know why the U.S. Attorney's Office of the Northern District is failing to investigate crimes of public corruption as well as the intentional targeting of me by the court system, by the legal system. I've got complete evidence. I've published the evidence. Why are you not doing your job, Bob? Why are you not doing your job?
You're full of shit.
I'm full of shit, huh? The Olive Branch Court arrests me for contempt for going up there to request public records. I get arrested for contempt for being baited to Olive Branch. You really are a piece of shit.
Good afternoon, U.S. Attorney's Office.
Yes, ma'am. I'm trying to figure out who I need to speak with. Who oversees y'all's department?
Is it the Department of Justice? Is that what you're asking?
Yes. Okay. Would I need to contact Jackson, or I feel like y'all's main job is not being done. I mean, I'm a citizen in the state of Mississippi. I was framed in what I think is the largest public corruption scandal. It involves people in the local government in Oxford. I've been calling now for 2 weeks. I've been leaving messages. I got a call that I missed last Friday, and I left a message, a voicemail, 2 days ago. I don't know what could be more important. Like, in 2 weeks' time, not getting one phone call. Go to the U.S. Attorney's Office, and something this big, somebody should have reached out to me by now.
Okay, one moment. I'm unable to assist you in this situation because I'm not exactly sure what's going on. I'm going to try to speak to someone who can hopefully help you.
I hope I can speak to somebody finally.
This is Robin. Sorry I'm away from my phone right now. If you'd leave a message, I will call you back as soon as possible. Thank you.
Robin, this is Matt Reardon. I left you a message 2-3 days ago now. I've been calling up there for about the past 2 weeks in regards to what I think is quite likely one of the largest public corruption scandals in the state of Mississippi, and I can't even get the U.S. Attorney's Office to give me a call back. It's a damn shame. So clearly I'm probably just going to have to go this route on my own. Just not even getting a call back. The U.S. Attorney's Office is not interested in
investigating this, much less hearing about it. Here in the office today, please give me a call back, 662-892-0132.
I gotta be honest with you, it really, really bothers me because the agency's tasked with protecting the American people are hurting the American citizens.
Not even help.
And I'd like to think that that's not what's going on up there, but 2 weeks' time, and I've stressed the importance of this, my time is running out. The statute of limitations is running out. Please give me a call.
Bob Norman. Finally caught you.
Excuse me, I'm on the phone.
Yes, sir. You've been a hard guy to reach. Well, I'm still trying to get to the bottom of everything. It's been fraudulent concealment out the ass. You know you guys are holding on to something they're not giving up.
You know what? There's no point in me responding to that because you're not gonna reason anyway.
I just want to know.
Ask you something. You know, talk about being a Marine Corps veteran.
That's right.
The Marine Corps kicked you out because you couldn't hack it.
They kicked me out because I couldn't hack it. I'd like to see. It's a general under other than honorable conditions for alcohol rehabilitation failure because
couldn't hack it.
No, because I witnessed two gruesome suicides because I couldn't hack it. Let me see your service. Where's your service record at, Blowhard Bob?
I spent 10 years in the Marine Corps. I came out with an honorable discharge.
Oh, yeah? So why can't you apply the law?
I do. You're a convicted felon.
Per the
right
to be in
now.
The Constitution,
get
I have
out of
every
my face.
Right
to obtain justice, to seek justice. Every right granted to me under the United States Constitution. Under the United States Constitution, you're a crooked son of a bitch.
FBI.
Yes, ma'am. I'm trying to get a 302 from 2017. The FBI has not been cooperative with me at all. I want to know if I can get, if I can come down there to the local branch, the field office where it was conducted, and get that 302 myself.
We're not really allowing anybody in our office from the outside right now because of COVID-19. All offices are operating at only 25% capacity, so there's not a whole lot that anybody can do about that, especially if you've already put in a request for it.
The FBI has not even so much as even spoken to me in regards to, I met with them the day before I was framed on a crime that I couldn't have committed back in 2017. They sat down with me. I had a death threat on me at the time. And, I feel like they through ultimately letting me drown in this and having proof that I couldn't have committed the crime, I would like to see the 302 from that sit down investigation, and I would also like to obtain the video recording in the conference room when the meeting was taking place, just to verify accuracy of the 302.
Video?
Oh, I know there were cameras present in the room.
I don't think we do not have, after a certain amount of time, that footage is erased, so I don't think we'll be able to obtain that.
What's the standard procedure for erasing the video?
Well, it does it automatically, so I don't know. That's up to our electronic technicians. They do that. They handle all of that.
But you don't know what the time frame is on that?
I do not. No, because I'm not an electronic technician.
Okay. Who would I need to speak with about that?
The Jackson office.
The Jackson office? Okay.
Do you want that number?
Yeah.
Okay. It is 601.
Okay.
948-5000.
5000? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just trying to see, if I came to the field office, if somebody could just meet me at the door with my request so that I could just get the 302, because, the court's not going to care about COVID-19 when it comes to my statute of limitations running.
Well, the court's not even open, so they should.
Well, I mean, still, it's going to be an argument that I'm going to have to go against as far as letting 3 years run. And here we have a pandemic that doesn't, quite frankly, doesn't have the, it's not even seeing the light of day as far as ending, so.
Okay. I have your information. I'm going to check around and see if I can find someone who spoke with you. Do you remember anything about the person? Any physical descriptions?
If you put my name into the system, they cannot sit down with me in a conference room and conduct an interrogation interview without there being a 302 that's created. That's standard protocol. 302 has to be created with an interrogation. It shouldn't be a matter of having to find the officer or the agent that met with me. It's just where's the 302? He shouldn't have to make it up now. The 302 is already made up.
Okay. The agent who conducted the interview would be responsible for the 302. So I do actually need to know who spoke with you.
Right, but y'all don't have a centralized system?
Look, I'm not allowed to
talk to you about our systems.
But no, but this is in regards to something that was created for me, you know, and it's very important to know. I mean, that's another thing that I can FOIA if I need to, as far as, you know, where are these 302s going? Are they not created and put into a centralized system? Surely they're not kept in the hands
not
in the.
Allowed
but
share
but
that
surely they're not kept. Surely they're not kept in the hands of the officer that conducted the investigation. That would be ridiculous.
Sir, I'm going to do my best. If you want to keep on, you can. But I'm going to do my best to get you what you need.
Okay.
I promise you that.
Okay.
I cannot share any information with you about our system. That is illegal.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. I've got your number. Is this your number? The 0132 number?
Yes.
Okay. I will be sure to call you back on that as soon as I come in contact with your 302, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye.
I think the big problem is that too many people are not seeing what's happening right in front of their very eyes. I think a lot of the problem comes from it not just being the lunatic left. It's calling for the disbandment of police stations and law enforcement agencies that are very much needed. It's the fact that these agencies are caving in and are creating the narrative that the evil mainstream media is trying to display. Everything continues to link itself together in some way directly aimed at me or my daughters. The state refusing to take any responsibility or accountability and continuing to persecute with the filthiest hands of all. Watch how the laws get bent and crafted to their choosing.
I'll move when I talk to Joey. Joey knows I'm out here waiting. He needs to come out and talk to me. I'll move when I talk to Joey. When Joey wants to talk to me, I'll move. Otherwise, I'm not breaking any law just for parking in a spot that says reserved for the Sheriff's Department.
One more
time. I'm here at the Sheriff's Department.
Move, or you will go to jail for disorder.
I'm not being disordered.
Okay,
I'm moving my car! I'm moving my car! I was moving my car! Ah! Hey! Ah! I said I was moving my car! Oh! Stop! Ah!
Matt Reardon, the Oxford Outlaw. I wanted to go ahead and I wanted to cap up what all just happened, what all just took place. Nothing really that big. In fact, I already put out an article about this. Had court at Justice Court in Lafayette County in front of the Honorable Mickey Avan, and I do truly mean that. He's one of the, I'll say he's probably the only straight judge that Lafayette County has when it comes to Justice Court. He's by the book. And that's the only reason why I decided I would go ahead and I would keep it in Lafayette County. I would fight it in Lafayette County. Judge Avan told me last week, he started reading my motion that I submitted. Hell, by now he's probably seen the video. He told me because he was the judge on the case and he saw that it started spilling into the details, he stopped reading it right there. So there was no, you know, in advance dismissing. Lafayette County is in fact not dismissing the charges. So I am in fact I'm giving Mickey Avan the benefit of the doubt here. I'm gonna let him try it because I think he can. Although I think that there are certainly a lot of conflicts of interest here in the area. I think that Mickey's going to look at the facts. And I think that regardless, I think that he would weigh it evenly. And I think regardless, he's going to come to the same opinion that I did. That in no way, shape, or form did anything that I did truly constitute an arrest by Courtney Dixon. Horrible state actor. Omar Ahmed, right there with him. Horrible. What was funny is, looking back at the police reports back from 2015, I was arrested for family disturbance by none other than Omar Ahmed and his partner, Courtney Dixon. Isn't it funny that they roll together even today? Joey East refused to speak to me. He watched like it was a spectator sport while they were trying to beat my ass in the parking lot. Well, I got news. $5 million counterclaim against Lafayette County. I'm getting it filed. Motion discovery and subpoena deuces tecum getting issued today. By now, I think I've sent the message that I'm not scared and I'm not back down. I'm not going anywhere. See, I was talking about the other day, there's so many ironic similarities to 2017, everything that happened in 2017. If you really start piecing it together, everything, and I mean everything, lines up. You have the Sheriff's Department that made a stupid arrest for disorderly conduct that really set everything in motion. You look at today, you had another stupid arrest by the Sheriff's Department for disorderly conduct. And they tagged resisting arrest in as a little added icing on the cake for them. They added in Olive Branch with a crooked judge over there when I was already victimized. But there's one thing different in 2020 and 2021. First being, I've spanned this thing out a lot longer. This is a quick, what they did 3 years ago was quickly thrown together without much preparation. What I'm doing now is 100% methodical. I'm premonition. I see what they're doing. I'm three moves ahead, but they weren't ready for me to take the battle straight to them. James O'Keefe just put out a message about exposing big tech. We can't forget to expose corrupt state actors. And that's what I'm doing. Check out MattReardon.com.
Nonsense. This is why departments across the country come under fire. This is why incidents escalate to absolute catastrophes that have snowballed out of control. This is how people get killed. It's past time that the state of Mississippi take responsibility for the faults of its own and stop criminally persecuting and enact to shield its tracks and cover its ass. The Mississippi government has now used bullying by badge and bars as a tool to invoke fear and steer its own preferable outcome and its own court of laws. The state of Mississippi is in direct violation of state and federal law. It's now gotten to extreme levels. All responsible parties in the state government need to be sued to high heaven civilly under multiple counts of 42 U.S.C. 1983 and 42 U.S.C. 1985. And damn it, they need to be criminally prosecuted under the RICO Act, as I've called for since day one, with a special counsel investigation and now congressional intervention due to it being allowed and condoned to carry on with the criminal web continuously sprawling out more and more. So, to fill you in, Friday I hand-delivered my inked letter to Blowhard Assistant U.S. Attorney Bob Norman, and I didn't have that nickname for him before until I figured out that his corrupt ass was part of the problem. So, what happened? I said, "Do you remember me?" He said, "I do." And he looked at me when he first saw me like he already knew exactly who I was. I knew he knew who I was. I just couldn't remember what his name was. I put my trust in this assistant U.S. attorney to guide me in the right direction or to take the evidence I already had and do something about it. The problem is, Because I'm not a disgusting liberal, because I'm not a socialist, because I'm not a Democrat, because I don't fit the agenda of this city that they're aggressively trying to shove down the throats of the citizens in this area, because I take a stand for what's right, for the Constitution, for Southern heritage. I had information that would have had ramifications on the incoming mayor and her husband back in May of 2017. I told Bob I was trying to find out why the U.S. Attorney's Office for the Northern District, which has a fiduciary responsibility, a moral responsibility, to investigate crimes of corruption and certainly to prosecute them if they exist, why over about 2 months' time, I got the runaround, I got kicked to the back. They refused to give me a call and look at all the evidence that I had gathered in regards to this being 100% framed, my civil rights being conspired upon to be removed. He wouldn't give me an answer. I had requested, and I have been long now in wait of, the 302 investigative report generated by the FBI from a sit-down meeting that I had with them May 25th, 2017, where I discussed the death threat that was on me, where I discussed how my rights, my civil rights, my First Amendment right to speak, as well as petition the government for a redress of grievances, how that was thrown away due to a cheap shot injunction. Anytime the FBI meets with a citizen, anytime that there's any kind of interview, especially at a field office like it was done, it's supposed to be done in the presence of a second agent. And that was the case. There were two agents that sat down with me in the conference room of the local field branch office in Oxford, Mississippi. In a FOIA request, a public records request, I have requested the 302 from that sit-down meeting to corroborate everything that I've said. I also know that the FBI is a politicized weapon. They've been a politicized weapon
they especially were activated as a political weapon. When the 45th President of the United States, Donald J. Trump, was elected to office. You see the proof with General Flynn, how the crooked FBI illegally wiretapped him in order to purposefully frame him to try to get inside of the Trump organization. And so I know not to trust the FBI to do the right thing. So in addition to this 302, which is missing according to the FBI, they will not respond to it. I also requested the video evidence of this sit-down meeting to corroborate the accuracy of the 302. And what do you know? The video is deleted after a certain amount of time that they could not specify the amount of time. They simply said that it's up to their technicians to determine. So when I pressed Bob Norman for this, for why they sat by with a moral and fiduciary obligation to answer the call for help to prevent public corruption, he wouldn't give me an answer. I asked him about why his office would not even so much as return a phone call to examine the evidence. He would not give me an answer. I said, Bob, your office, and this is why I put together the open letter that I did, because whether or not the U.S. Attorney for the Northern District of Mississippi wants to provide answer or not, that letter needs to go on file at the Department of Justice in Washington, addressed to Attorney General William Barr. This corrupt bullshit has gone on long enough. It's affected enough lives, it's destroyed enough lives, and God knows it's destroyed mine. Marine Corps veteran, patriotic citizen. My rights are brutally trampled on, and nobody seems to give a shit. And what is apparently a dumbed-down society from people drinking the Kool-Aid that's been given by our government pushing some kind of alternate plan here. And I have full faith and confidence and our Commander-in-Chief, Donald Trump. There are enemies of our country embedded in the alphabet agencies, such as this right here, the FBI, the CIA, the NSA, that are directly causing significant harm to our society. They're not going to stop. They're not going to back down until they completely destroy it. And it's on the citizens themselves to step up and grab the reins and either do something about it or allow it to happen. And if you allow it to happen, you're not going to have your opportunity to save it later. And that's why I'm taking the aggressive approach that I'm taking and trying to vindicate myself through Riding with the Outlaw to trying to get to answers. Assistant U.S. Attorney Bob Norman, when I told him that his office, that he and his office had a moral and fiduciary obligation to protect American citizens, to go after, to prosecute the real criminals. His answer to me, which was absolutely gawky, was our office is protecting
the American is protecting the public from criminals such as yourself, knowing that everything, the letter, the DVD that I just gave, everything that I've uncovered and I've published, there's absolutely no way I could have possibly committed the crime that they accused me of. The FBI knew it. That's why the 302 is missing. That's why they will not respond to the FOIA request. That's also why the Sheriff's Department in Lafayette County, as well as Lafayette County's attorney, when pressed for details about that May 24, 2017 phone call, which through the Sheriff's Office, through their own admission, was what sparked the warrant, what generated the warrant for them to come after me, for them to ambush me on the square in Oxford when I was going to a bar to sit down with a friend to have a beer on May 26th. That was what that came from. And this blowhard U.S. attorney wants to call me a criminal. He's the criminal. He's the problem. He is directly the problem. I wonder how many of these vehicles with dark tint driving by are FBI, the investigative arm of the U.S. Attorney's Office. These people picked a fight with the wrong one. Because honestly, like I said at the beginning, they can try what they want to try. This time around, I don't care. I'm not selling my soul to the devil a second time and pleading out to some bullshit that I didn't do. I'll sit it out like a patriot would, proving my innocence. I'm not allowing this to happen. Because see, here's the thing. I got four kids. Well, I got three that are biologically mine. All of them are girls. And if I sit back and allow this to happen, if society as a whole has been trained to turn a blind eye to something such as this, if agencies are allowed to conjure up anything that they want to conjure up in order to politically motivate another, in order to remove the liability off of an agency that made a false arrest at the beginning of that month, well then, my daughters, unfortunately, don't have a future or a shot in America anyways. Because America will have long consumed itself before then. So I owe it to them. And I also am doing this to help prevent something like this from happening again. The true criminals need to be held responsible. I couldn't remember if it was May 24th or May 25th that I met with Bob Norman, the assistant U.S. attorney, who then directed me to go and speak with the FBI about the issue. But my wife actually told me that she remembers fairly well that it was May 24th, 2017, that I spoke with Bob Norman. And May 24th, 2017 was coincidentally the day that the mystery phone call came into the Lafayette County Sheriff's Department, investigator Jared Bunder. And after the response,
that Bob Norman gave me on Friday for simply trying to hold his office accountable, for simply asking why they would not return a single phone call in regards to what was allegated as a horrible public corruption nightmare. A quid pro quo deal that benefited four separate parties, including the incoming mayor of Oxford, two bar owners, who they themselves were the one that started the little back and forth on Facebook, on social media. It benefited the Sheriff's Department in Lafayette County through the sham arrest that Tim Pruitt made May 1st, arresting me standing in front of the Confederate statue in Oxford on the square, holding the state flag of Mississippi because I didn't have a permit, and I asked him what his badge number was because he lazily forgot to put it on his uniform. That enraged him, and he made a wrongful arrest. And it also benefited the mother of my now six-year-old child, who's been used as a chess piece against me in a staged war of the courts, which, by the way, her attorney in the original child custody, Hill, the husband of the Oxford mayor. Ray Tannehill, by the way, 3 days ago was appointed by the Mississippi Supreme Court, was appointed to the Mississippi Bar Tribunal. You know, the people that ultimately decide if there was wrongful conduct committed by an attorney. He himself is part of this, played a huge part. In fact, I don't think that any of this would have gone on if it weren't for Ray Tannehill's involvement. I don't. How someone like himself gets appointed by the Mississippi Supreme Court to a position that he had absolutely no reason being in light of the serious allegations made, is beyond me. And it just shows how much tougher of an uphill battle this is going to be. That they are, one by one, maneuvering pegs in place to try to once again obtain a favorable outcome at the expense of another. And I myself am one by one putting pegs in place, victorious and vindicating myself, doing it in the name of justice and patriotism, and to bring the truly responsible parties to justice. In that open letter, go read it if you haven't read it yet. There's a landmark U.S. Supreme Court ruling by the late and great Judge Antonin Scalia. It was United States versus Williams, in which he ruled that the grand jury does not belong to any three branches of government. Rather, the grand jury belongs 100% in its entirety to we the people, and that by that the citizenry are empowered to impanel a citizen's grand jury to present evidence, to obtain indictments, to try and to mete out punishment to those convicted.
and I want this office right here behind me to do their job, to quit kicking the can down the road, to quit passing the buck, to do the job that they're tasked with doing, to produce the evidence requested, to give answer to the question stated in the letter, although I'm pretty sure that I'm going to be sending it to DC without any answers from the U.S. attorney, and that's just fine. But I think it's very ironic, I find it actually quite humorous, that 30 minutes until 5 o'clock, there isn't a soul at the U.S. attorney's office in the parking lot. Not only did they not fulfill their duties that they're tasked with, but not a soul up here working at 4:30. And these people are paid for by, guess who? You. Hold your people accountable. You only have one chance to do this. It's nearing bad times in America. Soros is trying to usher this in. Gates is trying to usher this in. Socialists are trying to usher this in. Take a stand for America before it's too late, folks. Matt Reardon, the Oxford Outlaw. Thanks for tuning in. Share this live stream.
On the way to Oxford, meet with Jeff McCutcheon, Oxford Police Chief. Greg, alignment with the Oxford Business Mayor, Robin Tino. I am just beyond amazement that not only was her first 4 years allowed, which is very open, but she's going for a second term, basically unchallenged, an 18-year-old. Brandon Pettis. I don't know much about Brandon. But I'll tell you this. I just about will stand behind anybody challenging Robin. I have one question. It's very odd. A Pettis signed as the clerk for the affidavit in 2017. Carolyn Pettis Bell was the judge that said $150,000 bond. And now Brandon Pettis is challenging.
Hey,
Jeff. How you doing, man?
Doing all right.
Doing good. Hello. So this is the, this is the boss's office, huh?
Yeah,
here
it
is. Over here.
I may have to reload it.
Okay. How do they get your MacBooks, huh?
No, this is my personal one. I'm going to show you what I would like to do.
Okay.
This is 24 minutes. You watch as long as you want to.
Yeah.
But this first image is the car.
Okay.
So I want to show you to the spot.
Yeah.
So you can see the driver. But then once they start giving him commands to get out, I want to switch it to the body camera.
Okay.
First 30 seconds is no sound. That's just the way.
I'm sure he probably didn't tell my wife certain things and
didn't see all that glare with him. It'll give you the sound I kept on here just a minute. When it hits 30.
Sure. It's decent quality.
Pick up
some.
There you go.
He was flying, wasn't he?
72 to 65.
I didn't recognize. Yeah, there are times that I don't recognize that I'm going as fast as I'm going.
It's
ADHD.
Yeah. Here's another
you know, my biggest complaint right now with the state is I've been denied, you know, the equal protection to the laws. I feel like I've demonstrated just ample, you know, just proof after proof of that, where it's like it's a steady witch hunt. You know, I feel like the clean hands doctrine is something that's utilized a lot in Chancery Court, and I think honestly, I think it should be utilized in. Okay.
That's a minute 36 for what he's got to go.
Was he speeding up, or was he going insane?
No, he did not do any evasive driving. He wasn't speeding. Jordan even says on his camera, we're doing about 450. He's not running fast. But you know, we're now right at 2 minutes. Now, obviously, he's in the zone. He can't pull over here.
Right.
We got a minute 36 of blue action.
Well, I think that, you know, knowing that that barrier, it's so uncomfortable with those two lanes right there. We got the nubs, and then it's already just, I'm surprised there didn't be more wrecks right there. But I know from the standpoint of a driver, as well as from the standpoint of law enforcement, I can totally understand wanting to find a place that you're not going to get hit,
sure,
you know, by a passerby, something that's more lit up. I think, you know, right there in front of the stores.
All right. So they're giving him commands, but I want to go to his body camera because you're not going to hear the audio.
Sure.
Yeah, this okay. is inside his car.
Sure.
And I'll let you, that's 2 minutes and 37 seconds. I'll let you watch the body camera that whole time too, so you'll know it.
Okay.
Wait to see everything. Hey, camera, it'll kick on in 30 seconds. I want you to see everything that was on that whole time.
No, I understand.
And then you'll eventually see where it picks up, where they even come in, to get out. But Jordan's body camera is actually better audio and visual quality.
Okay. Wait. He's pulling over. Okay. Jeff, that's not called for. You know that.
That's protocol.
That's not for. What if that was an old lady?
How do you know?
Right.
That's a guy with a weapon.
But what? If he was speeding up, if he was driving reckless, you know, if he was driving in a reckless way, I understand. But going, I mean, 45 miles an hour through a construction area. Come on.
No, he drove a minute and 30 seconds. Before he ever got into the construction.
Right, but the civilian population outside of law enforcement and military, everything's not down to a 1 second, you know.
But you keep watching.
Reaction.
They don't do anything unprofessional. They don't do anything outside of policy.
I think they're right there getting out of the car at gunpoint, and I mean, I can't see any movement in the car, but that right there was far too excessive.
It's not. Initially. How many traffic stops have you made?
I haven't made any, and I understand that this is y'all's ordeal. I'm just looking from the standpoint of, if I was a juror, mm-hmm. I would say a minute and a half in no way would constitute, because what if it was somebody that, and you know the new law as far as the little tag that goes on the license tag in the back or the back window of the car. Joe East put it on the Lafayette County website. Something about a decal, you know, if you have a impairment on, mm-hmm. you know, communicating.
Sure.
Which I think is a pretty, that's a new one. I've never heard of that. An impairment from communicating with like with law enforcement.
Well, it could be like autism or other issues where you don't, lights, flashes can freak you out. If you don't communicate well with that, then, you know, an officer wouldn't know that. They might think you're not being compliant.
Right.
That tag lets them know there's a communicative issue there.
Okay.
But that, for us, a minute and 30 seconds of travel time, what all I can do, what all I can put, what I can put in my mouth, what I can put on my body, They have to protect themselves.
They do, but if he's not, I mean, normally, you know, I could understand that if they had to deploy strips or if he was, you know, trying to speed away and they had to bring in additional units just to make the stop.
They needed a second officer there.
Right, but I don't think in a minute and a half it was needed. You know, he wasn't trying to drive away.
Almost 20 years of police work, a minute and a half to stop is not normal.
Yeah.
That's not normal.
Well, but is it normal when there's a very slim road that's, I think it's overly slim.
I'll go back and show you. He passes, I know, two exits where he could have turned off.
Right, but I know that when blue lights are flashing behind me, it's very easy, you know, to basically to kind of freeze up in the moment, to miss a turn, to it's to me it's an over processing thing that just on campus when I was pulled over this last time by a sheriff's deputy, I don't know how. I mean, I missed two different turning spots. It was icy outside, but I mean, just the blue lights flashing in the mirror, you know, just kind of disoriented me a little bit.
You can, but a minute and a half, just pull over.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? For me, just pull over.
Right.
And again,
but right, I understand. Okay, but did it justify the? I know the officer has to, you know. You have to assume, I don't think every situation calls for, you know, overdoing it to that level. Like I said, what if it was a grandma, you know, pregnant lady, a pregnant woman,
but we don't know those things.
Right.
You're talking about, is it possible? Right. We live in a world is, if it can happen, we have to prepare for it. And that's what they're doing here. They have a backup officer. He gives him command. And again, you'll see as we continue to watch it.
Did they, at any point, did he call in the tag, and did they call it back over the radio?
You just heard it.
Right, okay. I didn't know if I missed something. No,
that's why I want you to hear the whole body cam so you can hear everything internally. The only communication he had was, I'm trying to stop this car. His supervisor asked him, where are you going? What's the stop for?
Right.
What's the traffic light?
Okay.
You good? Empire. And they played, what's your name? Emmy. Your sister's just a big girl. She's not scared. Are you cold? It's windy. You got a coat? You got a jacket? That's not your jacket over there? Put your jacket on. You talk to my friend? Okay. What's up? She got out of the car scared. How are you getting out here? Oh.
Wrong. I don't know why they're asking that question. What do y'all want to do with him?
That's a fact.
This isn't a police state, though. Come on now.
Yeah, I think you can go by valid. Sarge, just letting know the situation. I'm gonna start doing paperwork though.
I mean, Jeff, I'm gonna have his back on this, and him and I are not even. We've got serious issues between us from the past. Like as far as me and her brother, we haven't even spoken. We haven't talked probably in 6 months.
Right.
And I mean, just. Trying to observe it from a, because it doesn't affect me really either way.
Doris was valid.
And if they didn't call the tag across, you know, first worry that hit my mind is not going to lie, you know, a felony stop, you know, if that wasn't just a new vehicle, you know, if he didn't call it across, he wouldn't just know that it's not like the Kia that just stands out where everybody knows that's me, you know, so that's a newer vehicle. So, I wanted to, first of all, make sure that, now I would like to see the video of the guy that stayed with the kids.
Okay.
And I'd like to see what all he was speaking with the kids about.
Okay. Just, you want to finish watching?
I mean, is there...
It's not even tomorrow.
I think they're making a mountain out of molehill with this.
What part do you
agree with? I just don't know what part you do agree with, Jeff. That's where I stand. No, I understand, but a minute and a half, and it was he hit the blue lights. Now, you know, I guess the only thing in question is where the blue lights were hit, and I mean, nighttime. My night vision is decreased anyways. There are so many different reasons why. I mean, I think 5 minutes, you know, going would have been excessive. I think that what, you know, the...
But who gets to pick what's excessive?
Right. Okay, so where's the law that says you have to pull over within so many feet or so many minutes of the blue lights getting hit?
Doesn't say that.
Well, there you go.
But what he said was, I pulled over because of the construction zone. That doesn't fly. I showed you, we're a minute 36 seconds before we ever get to the construction zone. So that doesn't fly. Now it's different if we're in the construction zone, but a minute and 36 seconds.
But coming up on that construction zone at nighttime, a time of limited visibility.
He said, I didn't want to pull over, we're in the construction zone. We're in construction zone after we go a minute and 36 seconds. Me and you can drive from here.
A minute and 36 seconds of being in shock because of flashing blue lights behind you. And then all of a sudden you're in a construction zone and you have to obviously get to the other side.
Maybe so. But that's more than what court is for.
I know. I'm just saying I know that I could, I would take that to trial and I would win a trial.
You'll have your opportunity.
Yeah.
But they did not do anything unprofessional. They were not ugly to him.
I think the way that they made the approach, the way that they made the initial contact was extremely excessive. Especially for the kids. And you know, this is even, and I know that he didn't know the kids were in there, but in this particular situation of what I've had to deal with and experience in the city, And my kids, I know it's not, but these kids, they didn't know the kids were in there, I know. But my kids that were in there, God help them. I mean, now I spent a day trying to convince them, you know, to not be, you know, scared. And then they draw their uncle out of the car at gunpoint with his hands behind his head.
Because their uncle didn't stop when he should have.
But I think that's... I'm not trying to.
None of that happened.
I agree. He could have pulled over a little bit sooner, right. But the officer also didn't have to draw at gunpoint unless he was making any kind of erratic moves, unless he was actually speeding up. He was staying the same speed.
That is all totality of a search. You don't get to pick that sitting here in an office chair out at 5:34 in the afternoon. You're not out there on the scene. That's not you standing with an unknown person. You don't get to make that decision.
Right, but we were trained for that in the Marine Corps.
Okay.
As far as, you know, obviously...
orders and police orders.
I understand. Police should not be as militarized as the military. And I know the military wouldn't draw somebody out and backwards in that way.
That is a standard way to take someone out of power.
When you actually ascertain that it's a felon, a minute and a half is not grounds to pull somebody out at gunpoint like that. It's not.
I disagree.
I we can agree to disagree on that, Jeff, but
my safety for me as a police officer going out there, I don't have to walk up to that car and approach and put myself at risk.
No, I know.
You couldn't stop. You could have gotten there. We could have done this just like we always do.
But there's no tint on the windows. It's completely clear.
That's all you got to do to kill somebody.
I know.
Just that quick. So what they did was tactically sound and safe for not only us, but also him. They didn't scream at him. They didn't cuss at him. They didn't get rough with him. That was professional.
It didn't escalate any more past that, fortunately. I just think that. And it fell within Terry stuff, but the probable cause for the dog and wanting to search the vehicle, I mean, I still haven't heard any, you know, really any probable cause to even warrant asking to search the vehicle.
Matt, because what are you doing for two minutes before you ever pull over? You can hide evidence, you can hide drugs, you can hide weapons, you have no clue. But you got people unrestrained children in there, we don't know what's going on. You have to assume anything is on the table at this point until you prove it's not.
Been there, done that, man. On a daily basis. Yeah.
You know what I started for? He said, no, you cannot. K-9 officer's already on scene. Wow. He was right. He loves the dog. We don't search that car. We don't search it.
You're right. And I know it could be easy for that dog to hit. You know, like as far as like I've seen things, and it may not be true, but I've seen like shows or YouTube channels and all where, you know, people have certain commands will make the dog,
right,
basically, like, right. So
if they were trying to,
they could have easily, yeah.
They didn't do that.
All right, what's your phone number? 600. All right, you're going to get the lead here. Okay. Had they not been in the vehicle, and I'd be having to file something to do with them, might would take you to jail over all this. You are about to get quite a few tickets. All right. Next time, just pull over. I'd have wrote you a ticket for speeding or let you go with a warning. That's the same thing. Because you got to pull up real quick, okay? When you get there, you got to pull up. What I mean? That was all but an effort. Like, we were calling out a pursuit, okay? That's my five car shooting.
I mean, I understand, but I did slow down. I got to make sure to slow down so you knew I wasn't going to run. I wanted to pass the instruction. My father in law is a pilot, man.
Well, you're getting a citation for speeding. Fair yield to emergency vehicle. Two trial restraint violation. And insurance.
You also out the insurance ticket. I'll show you the insurance on it. It's insured. There's no point in taking another ticket to trial.
It has. We don't. You have to talk to Dr. Patriot City Board. We don't get involved.
There's nothing more safe about here than where we were at. I hit my blue lights well before the construction zone. Huh? It's on video.
40. I gotta get her before 6 at Lafayette.
We're down on all these tickets, May 12th and 9 a.m. Phone number and address right here at the bottom, okay? If you have any questions, turn around, Mom. Take your handcuffs off.
Yeah, can you take that officer that was there with the kids?
He has not docked his camera.
He hasn't?
He hasn't docked his camera.
Okay.
He'll be back to work tonight, so I'll get him to dock and then I'll get back up with you.
All right. And who was that?
Steven Shear.
Okay. Yeah, I'd just like to see what that other officer was saying.
Right, sure.
And obviously, you know, it's got a lot of, I'm not trying to point a guilty finger or come into it with a negative aspect. I've learned I have to.
Mm-hmm.
This whole thing from 2017 just bothers me to a level of, you know, I made a lifelong oath to my country, to our government, to uphold and defend the Constitution, to protect it, our country, basically. And constitutionally, I did nothing wrong. You know, legislatively, constitutionally, I did nothing wrong. You know, politics has involved itself, wedged itself. I quite frankly, I don't know how Tannehill hasn't been, you know, hauled off and cussed yet. Her entire last 4 years was illegitimate. I mean, this is a fraudulent election. They silenced me using bullying and badges to you know, put me behind bars from a week before she was elected to a week after she was sworn into office. And then they banished me for 5 years, effectively trying to get rid of the problem, not realizing that I was, you know, 2.5 years in. You know, I could get off of probation, but they didn't afford me a preliminary hearing. I tried to assert my innocence. I met with the FBI a day before I was ambushed on the square because I had a death threat that was made towards me. I confided in Assistant U.S. Attorney Bob Norman, told him that I had a death threat, told him that I was scheduled to speak at City Hall on June 6th, the day of the election. And it's in the local voice. I actually have the article. I'm scheduled right after Joey East to address. And they literally effectively stopped that by taking out an emergency injunction on me, which was for constitutionally protected activity. It's actually named in the affidavit. And, you know, he had me sit down with the FBI. I discussed all this with the FBI and how I had purchased an AR-15 on May 20th to protect myself and my family, you know, military style, against any kind of threats that were coming my way, because I had a death threat that was made that my ex sent me proof of.
Right.
Well, I mean, for me to be guilty of the state's crime of honor before May 8th, I put Todd and Ashley Lynch in fear of their life with the AR-15. It would have obviously make it to where I'm lying to the FBI. So why have I not been charged by the feds? You know, one way or the other, I want to compel a trial.
Mm-hmm.
One way or the other, there needs to be a trial on this, because the state of Mississippi, in trying to cover its own back, its own liability from the huge just vomit that it, you know, splashed everywhere, they continue to leave a wake trail three times wider in its path,
right,
trying to cover up one thing after the other. And I've termed it trickle-down corruption. You know, it starts with one person, somebody that's got a lot of power, like Ray Tannehill, for example, his wife running for mayor. And it quickly just thunderbolts itself into other people helping them. Before you know it, you have good people that are hired to do a job and have been doing a job, you know, the right way, constitutionally the right way. And it puts them in a bad position of, I either do what's right, what I took an oath to do, or I don't. And if I don't, I open myself up to liability. But if I do, I could be fired, or I could be, you know, put in a worse position.
Right.
And it just, before you know it, and that's what I've demonstrated with riding with the outlaw. This thing has turned into an avalanche. The FBI has destroyed records. I'm going to be suing the FBI, the Department of Justice, really, because the U.S. Attorney's Office and the FBI is involved in this. I trust the U.S. Attorney's Office. In turn, the FBI destroyed records.
Right.
I wanted that to prove what I was saying was, in fact, the truth.
Right.
They were like a lifeguard watching a child drown, tasked with watching over a pool and just letting a child drown. It's culpable negligence. You know, you knew that I was innocent the entire time, allowed me to sit in jail for 6 weeks knowing that I had a child to support that was sucked into the middle of a court battle right there because she was taken away from me. This thing involves four parties. I've tried to bring this stuff to the authorities, to the proper authorities. The FBI doesn't care. They told me four different times they're going to call me back, and they won't. I called the U.S. Attorney's Office for 6 weeks straight. They don't care. They never returned the phone call because they're complicit.
Right.
And who do you go to for help? That's why, you know, I'm basically on my own. I have no attorney. And I'm having to play, you know, officer, attorney, and basically, you know, I'm in a Supreme Court appeal right now. on that.
Right.
It's just, it's not fair. I obviously have a lot of trust issues.
Sure.
And it's appalling to me that the news media is the biggest enemy of the people, because, you know, they are intentionally keeping this quiet when they were the first to smear my name with the accusation, smear my name whenever I pled out, but failing to report that I was kept in jail for 6 weeks despite me trying to assert my innocence. A preliminary hearing was cleared up. My bond was set 3 times higher than the maximum for a charge up to 10 years. In the penitentiary, it's a $5,000 to $50,000 bond is what it's set by the Supreme Court. Carolyn Bell sets it at $150,000. Same judge that set an accused rapist and kidnapper at $10,000 apiece less than a year later. So a patriot that never actually put anybody in harm, that, you know, just advocated for the state flag and carried a gun, a Marine Corps veteran, gets treated 75 times worse. And,
I don't like
yeah, but I understand your frustration.
No.
Well, I don't think you're the only one.
I'm a great hair father.
Now, let me explain why Daddy did the mohawk, okay? Because it's important for you to know that here lately, over the last year, one of our fundamental rights as Americans, freedom of speech, has come under attack big time. Big time. And you know what? When freedom of speech comes under attack, the only thing to fall back on, fall back to, is freedom of expression. Just like you with your purple glasses, okay?
Oh.
You know? There are a lot of people that don't like purple. So what?
What?
All in all, those proven corrupt acts of our government branches and its complete abuses of power caused me to lose trust and hope in our government. A complete lack of trust and faith in our government's alphabet agencies, by ways of these agencies selectively enforcing the law, and even worse, persecuting innocent citizens based on political reasons. Politics has absolutely no place in law enforcement, and it definitely has no place in the courts. The courts should condemn this type of behavior. Sanctions, slap on the wrist, are never enough when it comes to the rights of a citizen being trampled on at the hands of a public corruption scandal. Public corruption, especially involving government officials working in an official capacity, warrant nothing shy, in my opinion, of capital punishment due to the complete, absolute treasonous nature, not to mention the peace, dignity, and integrity of the state and our government that may never truly be. Law-abiding citizens are all too often accused of crimes they did not nor would not ever commit. They are pressured. Some are even threatened with the targeting of others close to them. The threat of lengthy incarceration and the concern that every parent should have of both providing for and being there for their children. I didn't stand a chance of my own at the time everything happened. When you take into consideration all the different factors, and one of the best thought out, highly connected, and tightly woven conspiracies that protected those involved, being that all three branches of local government, the executive, legislative, and even judicial, were involved, along with multiple attorneys and at least one federal three-letter alphabet agency, the FBI. There was local law enforcement that framed me, but it was law enforcement on a federal level that stood by doing absolutely nothing at all, while all along having proof I couldn't have possibly committed the crime in question. It's no different than a lifeguard whose sole job is to keep watch and keep those swimming safe. What would you do? What would you think if you saw the lifeguard standing around with his hand in a cookie jar, just watching a child drown? especially if you're too far away to save the child yourself. You'd feel lifeguard caused the child to die by neglect, from not acting, anger, confusion, and untrusting of that lifeguard would be pretty fair emotions that most would exhibit. Would you allow your child to swim unattended under that lifeguard's watch? Or would that one incident cause you to permanently lose trust in that lifeguard? Even all lifeguards for that matter.
Let me see your service. Where's your service record at, Blowhard Buff?
I spent 10 years in the Marine Corps and came out with an honorable discharge.
Oh yeah? So why can't you apply the law?
I do.
Now imagine being framed for something way out in left field. Imagine being treated like a prisoner at Guantanamo Bay, being shackled at the wrist, waist, and ankles in an orange jumpsuit, and walked via 2 to 3 deputies out in the most public of spaces, ending up in the famous and ancient courthouse in the middle of the city, where over the weeks prior, you had so proudly stood cherishing and showing public support for the very freedoms afforded to every citizen, the freedoms that now landed you in this very place, and done for 3 reasons in particular. One of them being a publicity stunt brought about by their all-out assassination on a private citizen's rights. And shockingly, it's definitely not the worst. I directly hold the FBI and U.S. Attorney's Office accountable for turning a blind eye and choosing to obstruct in their own ways my ability to properly see vindication based on evidence. The local government will have to answer to several integrity questions posed, such as why they so easily allowed banishment on a sentence, and they're protecting their dirty ways through methods such as covenants not sue. I intend to prove that which I already know, the motive, the reasons why I was the fall guy for this.
Calling WREG.
Yes, ma'am. I was calling. I really don't know who I need to speak with up there. It's funny. I was just thinking about this. I was telling my wife about this earlier. I remember a time growing up when I was a child that I used to idolize the news, the people that I saw on the news, and thought that they were out for the better will of the people and not more of a government propaganda machine. But I mean, over the last 3 years, I've sat back dumbfounded at, you know, the tactics that have been deployed. I don't know how you people sleep at night. This is Matt Reardon.
This is the Field Manager. Hold on a second.
Okay.
Thank you for calling WREG TV and WREG.com. You have reached the voicemail for Sarah Van Arnum, the assistant instructor. I'm sorry I'm not able to answer your call. Please leave your phone number or email address, and I'll return your call promptly. You can also press 0 to reach the operator. Thank you for reaching out to WREG and WREG.com. Please leave your message after the tone. When done, hang up or press the pound key.
Sarah, my name is Matt Reardon. The news desk just sent me to you because I guess they didn't want to hear the truth. So they just hit the send to the manager's voicemail button. As I was saying, there was a time I was reflecting back. There was a time growing up I used to idolize people that I saw on the news. I used to think that they were out for the better will of the people, better good of the people. I never would have thought that they would have just simply been a government propaganda machine. To modify what news people hear, what news is reported on. But I've sat back for 3.5 years after being framed by the local government, which has actually involved the state government as well as the Department of Justice, knowing that I couldn't possibly have committed a crime that I was framed for, I was charged with as part of a political stunt to get me out of the way to help elect Socialist Mayor Robin Tannehill. the entire last 4 years as mayor for her has been illegitimate, fraudulent, called into question. I've produced nonstop evidence of this, about how this was a quid pro quo plot. She has been well aware of everything that has gone on, yet it has been crickets. God help, if I had done something actually truly wrong, the news would have picked me apart to pieces. But I have reached out to every news station in the Mid-South, shown the undeniable proof, shown the evidence of the FBI getting rid of records that were counter to them, that showed that they knew, they were complicit in this thing from the beginning. And here you have an innocent American, Marine Corps veteran, that pledged a lifelong oath to his country to protect and defend it and its Constitution. Never once did I put anybody in fear of their life. Never once did I commit a crime. But because I was counter to their agenda back in 2017, I was framed for a crime I couldn't possibly have committed. Given a bond 3 times higher than what the allowed maximum was. Denied an opportunity to get out, to prepare my case, to show my innocence, even though I asserted it the entire time. And meanwhile, the media is playing a complicit hand in everything. There couldn't be any more evidence to the fact of everything that I've laid claim to. All I've tried to do was get an evidentiary hearing to clear my name, but yet Robin Tannehill can sit there in office as mayor, refusing to acknowledge anything, refusing to even answer any questions with the most serious of accusations made. She can stay quiet and then run for a second term as mayor, and the corrupt news media is just basically propelling her. They're not holding these elected officials accountable the way that they should and conducting interviews. All I've asked was to be interviewed. I want the truth to come to light. If they can do this, if the government can do this to somebody that made a lifelong oath, that pledged a lifelong oath to their country to protect and defend it, they can do it to anybody. This is a matter of principle. And I'm pretty sure if anybody in y'all's organization was targeted the same way and was fighting for air, fighting for breath, fighting for their life, for the sake of their children, I'm pretty sure y'all wouldn't be keeping this just muffled silent. It's absolutely disgusting. I don't know how individuals in the corrupt news media sleep at night.
Thank you. Goodbye.